And you're here all week flying, but I wanted to kind of walk around the F-35, if we can do that before we jump into that. Just real quick, you started off flying fifth gen your entire career, so F-22 to the F-35. Quick differences, what do you think between the F-22 and F-35?
Yeah, they're actually very, very similar tactically, and so how we employ the airplanes, the sensors, all that sort of capability. Raptor optimized for air-to-air, F-35 more optimized for air-to-ground, but they can both do some similar missions. So that's pretty cool that we'll both be out there night one doing the fifth-gen mission.
Yeah, it's awesome the fact that you've flown both, because there's only a handful of people that can say that, so it's pretty cool. Now, I will give you grief because you've never had a Mexican radar.
I'm a really bad pilot.
Yeah, I never had to actually work for anything, but it's awesome. So you mind kind of walking us around just a little bit and kind of show and tell? What is this thing hanging out up front underneath here?
Oh, this guy. So this is our EOTS, or our T-flare, so our targeting infrared system. So there's an IR camera in here that can see basically heat signature differences. We use that to generate coordinates for our laser guided bombs or our GPS guided bombs. And then it also does have a laser component so we can guide those LGBs in.
So you have a funky looking helmet that you're wearing. Is there anything on the jet that allows you to kind of see what's going on in and around you? Can you talk me through that?
Yeah, sure. Most popular question, actually.
Yeah,
so we've got six of these around the airplane. There's also a different wavelength of IR camera in there, primarily used for missile warning, but it does have a 360-degree video around the airplane, and we can put that video onto our visor to be able to, you can see through the plane, see through your body. But honestly, that video we actually use as night vision primarily.
Really?
Yeah,
because no night vision goggles like you'd find in the Raptor F-20 or in the F-16, like traditional fighters.
Right.
That's actually coming from the sensors around the jet.
Yeah, we have a night vision camera in the helmet that works similar to MVGs, same technology, but this IR video is actually better fidelity, so we use that.
Really?
Mm-hmm.
That is interesting, because for those who don't know, like, I mean, when you're looking at MVGs, you're looking through the soda straw and you have to whip your head around back and forth, and you don't get depth perception, you don't really have a great field of view. I mean, you have a terrible field of view. But how is it, comparatively speaking, like having that SA-wise, does it really help?
Yeah, it's still all a shade of green. You're seeing, you know, the IR stuff. Fidelity is, you know, it's like flying around at night. It's not the best. But.
Yeah, it doesn't turn night into day.
No.
Well, that, I mean, it's cool because there's a lot of like awesome features on F-35 that we can't talk about. But some of these pieces are really neat to know, I think, for people to like know, hey, there's some amazing technology. Speaking of which, I know we mentioned the helmet. Like, how much does the helmet cost?
Around $400,000.
It's an expensive.
It is expensive, yeah.
So the capability that that gives you, can you talk to me, like, what makes that unique and what's different?
Yeah, sure. I mean, I came from the Raptor, which had no helmet, pretty much.
Yeah, you're a speed.
No off-foresight.
Speed lid.
And so coming from that to basically, you know, an upgraded Jehimix where you've got the F-35 helmet on, it's awesome having the off-foresight. I mean, I can be looking back here, see AOA, my altitude, airspeed, but primarily the situational awareness it gives you with the tactical environment. So look around and see symbology of everything you have in your shoot list, your wingman, just to gather that SA that you didn't have without that, for example, the Raptor.
So I talked to Dojo, who is a Strike Eagle pilot and obviously the predecessor for you. You're coming from fifth gen to fifth gen. Dojo was explaining, he came from the Strike Eagle, but he was saying that a wingman coming out of the B course in the F-35, he said he would equate that to like a four-ship flight lead as far as like the situational awareness they have running the air picture and things like that. Do you think that's a true statement?
Yeah, absolutely. And we have to train them to that capability because we fly, you know, in fifth gen formations, which can be 60 miles wide away from each other. So to be able to trust that wingman that's 15, 20 miles out there to do their own thing and kind of think like a thinking wingman versus being in that visual formation, it's crucial. And we've got guys coming straight out of pilot training to the F-35, and 6 months later, they're a flight lead on their way to instructors. So, like, it's a lot for them to handle, but I think it's growing up in a video game world helps a lot.
That is true.
The millennials. The
joke I always make, like, you know, F-16, it's like the Nokia, like the brick phone, and then now the stuff you're jumping into, it's the iPhone. The technology is just so vastly different.
Absolutely.
Which is what we need as we march into like the next fight.
Yeah.
Can we walk around just a little bit? Oh, I see. This is non-tactical questions, but obviously we have the ladder to get in and out, which I don't think, do we have any other fighter that has its built-in ladder other than the Hornet?
The Hornets do.
But that's it.
But
that's
gotta
be a Navy.
It's pretty convenient.
Do you like that?
Yeah.
And this is the only thing, I saw like the travel pods down there.
Yeah.
Do you fly with travel pods on the jet?
I do every cross country, yeah.
Okay.
So we pack, actually all of our swag goes in those, my duffel bags, you know.
I don't think Dojo flew with travel pods. Maybe
oh,
I missed
really?
It. Yeah.
Not during the show.
Right, yeah, obviously not during
like,
the show.
Yeah, 5G limited.
That thing's
gone.
So
yeah, cross country.
Yeah, all right. Yeah. I did not know that, so that's cool. Yeah. I would like to kind of walk back, talk about the motor, talk some engine stuff. Bird's got it, I see, you know.
Oh, they tagged this one real good.
So I've flown in formation in the slot underneath the F-35, and like the rumble in the jet, like the F-16 is shaking back there.
Yeah.
This is a big old motor. Can you tell me a little bit about this?
Yeah, so the F-135 Pratt & Whitney engine, 43,000 pounds of thrust and afterburner, which, I mean, you talk to the P-51 guys when you fly with them, and they're like, it is loud when you start to push that engine up. So we don't have thrust vectoring like the Raptor, but super capable engine. We don't do the hover mode, obviously, so this
no
is the A model variant. Yeah.
Why would you need to do
too
that?
Scary.
So, and you mentioned like flying with the Mustang, so you're doing a lot of different flying, doing demos, but you're flying a jet that likes to go fast with planes that can't go as fast.
Yeah.
What are your thoughts, like heritage, what are some of the challenges when you mix up a P-51, an F-86, an F-35, and a, God forbid, an A-1 Sky Raider, which I know you're going to fly with today.
That was a little rough last night.
Yeah, gosh, that thing is so slow.
Yeah, it's different, like you said. We train every year with them to kind of get used to the differences. Every heritage pilot flies their profile differently too, whether they use more altitude, fly tighter turns. So you're flying at 15 AOA, which makes the flight controls more sluggish. But it's tough, but it's a challenge, which is the fun part of it.
To me, it was like my favorite part of doing it. Like, it's pretty cool when you're flying on the wing of a 70-year-old warbird, but there's a lot of responsibility that comes with that too, because you have an ejection seat, they don't, so you better not suck when it comes.
They tell you day one, don't touch me. I got it.
It's the scariest thing, but also it's like the most awesome thing. You get used to doing it, but it's still like the coolest thing to watch flying around.
Yeah.
I will also say flying with the Sky Raider, like that was super painful. I know Stuart loves flying that thing, but
it's super smooth, which is good.
Yeah. Is your jet yelling at you? Like it was yelling at me in the Viper.
We get the gear warning horn constantly. So it doesn't like being that low and that slow without the gear down.
So I do, I've talked to a couple like Viper guys who've transitioned to this. So doing SFOs, simulated flame out patterns in the Viper, if your engine fails, you gotta be able to do it. To say now, like, it's completely different than what we did in the Viper, what you might do a straight in for or do an SFO for, because once this thing gets going fast, like, it doesn't want to stop.
Yeah, I mean, you saw the rejoin last night, a little sporty, and then there's no dedicated speed brake in it. So if you put the speed brakes out, it's using the flight controls and deflecting those to try to slow you down. But if you're flying the airplane, it's going to prioritize the flying over the speed brakes. So it's a little bit tough, and she doesn't slow down.
So how do you, like, so the rejoin you did last night, the way I would do that rejoin is I'm obviously G-ing my face off, but then like a full boot of rudder, which is probably like there's probably some design limit that I was exceeding there. I doubt it. But no, like the full boot of rudder, but it's allowing me to make that rudder input to put our barn door out to slow down. But in the F-35, if you do that, it's going to say probably.
Yeah, there's so many control laws with the fly-by-wire system in this airplane and the Raptor that you get different things based on what regime of flight you're in,
right. What
AOA, what airspeed. So I can ask for, you know, max left roll or full boot of right rudder. And sometimes I'm getting yaw, sometimes I'm getting side slip. It's all based on that regime, and how the airplane deflects the flight controls is totally different depending on how you're flying the airplane and where you are in the world. So like altitude-wise. Yeah, it's weird.
Comparing that to like the Raptor, like, it's got to be somewhat similar, but
they are very similar. Yeah, they both get into like pitch rate versus nose rate command. You know, different things once you get into post stall regime, what you're asking for, yaw, side slip with the pedals.
Okay, I'm also digging like, so obviously you fought Raptors, I fought Raptors. It was a different story as I was just watching, like trying my best. Have you fought Raptors in this doing BFM?
I did fight Cabo. Did not go well.
We
were up in flying out of Selfridge in the London Air Show, and the four of us, the four demo pilots, went up into Omoa and fought each other. Fortunate dissimilar. It was pretty fun.
That's epic. What are your thoughts between, you know, flying the Raptor and flying this?
The biggest difference, thrust vectoring is a big deal. And being a Raptor baby, I didn't really notice that until I came to this airplane, and then you high AOA, post stall maneuvering, very maneuverable, but thrust vectoring is a game changer.
Because when you're doing the thrust vector in the Raptor, I mean, it's whatever you want to do, it's doing it. There's obviously nothing you're having to command to move the nozzles, right?
So it does it automatically in certain regimes of flight, slow speed. But when you're pulling on the stick and you can just have nose authority to do whatever you want almost and just hang the airplane up, It's so different versus, you know, fourth gen or this airplane, it's just sinking.
Yeah.
It's just different.
It is a sinking feeling when you're fighting a Raptor, just like doing your best, looking over your shoulder, but like that's what you want.
And they can just point their nose at you all day long.
Some guys have it, some guys don't. Like, it would be nice. Any other like big highlights? Obviously the F-35 had a little bit of bad press. I always say, you know, we're really thinking about like the next generation fight, near-peer threats. And the A-10 is great, don't get me wrong. Big gun, it's great. But I think there are some things this can do that we need it to do. So what would those takeaways be?
I mean, the amount of SA and battle space awareness that we can have in this, because of the amount of emissions that it sucks in and shows you on your display, is game changing. Like, that is our advantage. We've got like a 1-foot by 2-foot touchscreen in the airplane, and the amount of info, like you talked about it, young lieutenants coming in and flying the airplane, that is the hardest thing to teach them.
Yeah.
Because there is so much info, and there are so many decisions to make by processing all of that. Us with the Raptor next door on night one is like, that's why we win the fight.
It's a slaying machine. You did hit on like sharing the info. And I know the Raptor's like working on it, but when I flew with F-35s doing exercises, I was so much more lethal because of the information that the F-35
Absolutely.
Was sharing. It was having big brother or big sister there, like watching and kind of guiding the fight, which is a complete game changer. So it's really cool.
Definitely.
Awesome. Bayo, I know you gotta get ready to fly. There's lots of awesome jet noise around and above.
Yeah.
So thanks for taking the time.
Absolutely.
I really appreciate it.
Of course.
Awesome. Thanks so much.
Yeah.